Good morning. You gotta love God, I tell you. How's everybody today? Happy New Year to those of you who I didn't say Happy New Year to last week. So I trust all is well and all will be well and all will go well. Like Dr. Deborah said, what we're going to do is we're going to start off this year doing the first four chapters of the Science of Mind textbook, which Dr. Ernest Holmes wrote, who is really the founder of religious science. And the reason we're going to do that is so that what we can do is we can set the groundwork for what's going to happen for the next 52 weeks of this year, which is really about bringing our own true selves out in 2012. I can't remember the exact phrase. To live our life in purpose and to be able to bring it forward. And what I found in the past is that the first thing that I require in my life before I can really put myself into something and allow myself to be able to commit to be able to work forward is I need to have a definition of what I'm looking at or what I'm doing. And quite often in this teaching, what we uncover or what we find is that the words that we use that are symbolic of something don't necessarily reflect what we want them to reflect. So when I talk about God or spirit, the uncovering that I sometimes find is that a lot of people immediately feign back to their old concept or their own belief of what God would be. And so if I were to stand here for the next 52 weeks, or anyone else for that matter, and speak on the term of spirit or God and put it forward, and you were to assume that I was talking about that one that comes from the past, that idea that has evolved in this center that has come forward and that Dr. Holmes wrote about in the first chapter of the Science of Mind textbook, The Thing Itself. If I were to talk about that without you knowing that, that you might actually think that I'm talking about that God that traditionally a lot of us were raised to believe. You know the one that I'm talking about, I trust, and I certainly know that it's got some value. And I know that when it was presented and put forward in our past, that it fit the consciousness or the evolutionary consciousness of the existence of people at that particular time, which is why quite often it was given something in a very human form for us to be able to hang on to and recognize what it was, such as a Jesus or a Buddha. That which is indescribable, that which cannot be defined is the power that we talk about and which Holmes talks about and calls the thing itself. What we're accustomed to, or I will speak for myself, what I was accustomed to was believing that this thing called God, this spirit that was referred to as God, was indeed some paternal subject who sat in the clouds and looked down on earth and witnessed what was going on and kept notes and score to make sure that everything worked the way he wanted it to work. Perhaps that reflects some idea of the God that you might have been raised with? No? Okay. Yes? Okay, well, whatever. You know the one I'm talking about, the one that lives up in the clouds that nobody really knows or can't see. The one that when we take the space shuttle up or even go to Mars, for some reason we can't find that cloud and how it works. But that one that sits there, and I always used to picture it as sitting in a white robe with a big white beard with a big black pen and a red pen in front of him on a huge desk and sitting there with a scroll in front of him and having his angels run around as both clerks and enforcers to make sure that everything was done in the pattern and the way of expectation for his subjective desires or whatever was going to go on. And even when I was taking philosophy and going through it, what I was finding was that although other people referred to it in a different form, that was still the dominant belief or thought that I had. So believe me, I respect those people who, when they're leaving on a Sunday morning, say, "I'm never coming back here again. You say God way too much." And I also respect the ones that who leave and say, "You know what, I'm never coming back again to this church because you don't say God enough." And believe me, they're about equally weighed when they leave here or when they arrive in what they're looking for or what they're seeking. And the God that I'm talking about is the God that is a system. It is an operational system. It is something that works, as Dr. Holmes said, on two basic principles, and that's love and law. And that love shows the way and law makes it happen. And it's not saying that there's two ideas or two gods. What it's saying really is that there are two characteristics that it operates from consistently and constantly. So when I use the term God or Dr. Deborah or one of our ministers or most anybody who would speak from this stage in this center uses that term God, what we're really talking about is we are talking about that infinite system of life that operates according to law in perfection, always for the highest and greatest good, no matter what, no matter how, no matter where, no matter when. And that it operates through us. And that it doesn't sit at a desk somewhere taking specific notes on good and bad so that it can both punish and reward in accordance. As a matter of fact, what punishment and reward are is the law in action within ourselves reflecting out what it is that we think about the experience or the thing that we might have done or the thing we might want to do. And that it is gives back to us in perfection exactly as we think, exactly how we think. Dr. Holmes begins the chapter, as a matter of fact, he talks about there will come a time when we all wait for it, when religion and science will walk hand in hand into the visible from the invisible. What he's talking about is there will come a time when we understand that this entity that we have put so much power into and personalized and anthropomorphized to such a degree, there is a time when we will understand that that is not an entity, but that is the system of life itself that operates not through any one entity, but operates instead through every entity. Everything that exists in our lives, everything that we can see, everything that we can experience, and everything else that we don't, in fact, is a reflection and part of the body of that which we call this system of God. And when I say part of the body, it is because the infinite universe itself is the body of spirit. It is the tangible form that we can see. And this is why we are known in this teaching, we are defined as panentheists. And what a panentheist is a panentheist is someone who believes in the immanence and transcendence of spirit. Of God. And when we can understand that the system operates not on a list of rules, that it isn't personalized to each and every one of us in the system that it judges, when we understand that and understand that in fact what it is that it is the very, very core of our being, each and every one of us and everything we see, and that what it does is it expresses itself through the form of its own being. And that we are that form. And therefore, it cannot deny us, and it must be free to be able to operate through us. And what stops and blocks us in our society and in our individual lives is the simplest thing possible. And that is that it is done unto us according to our belief, because it works on the premise that what we impart to it becomes our reality. What we put into the life of life comes back to us pressed down and flowing over, because we are the mind that we talk about as spirit and God, but we are not its completeness, we are the limited idea or belief in it. We are the concept that sets up according to our own belief systems and standards and our own judgments to a large degree. And because we do that and we operate from that, we are penalized by our own selves according to our own belief system and our own ideas and our own way that we examine and put out and experience life around us. Does it make sense? And that is as opposed to what? The spirit that sometimes resides within us, that idea, that entity that is called God, that punishes based on the fact that who knows what? Some subjective idea, that idea that kind of says, I'll take little Johnny today, but a little Susie's been good, so I'm going to reward her. And we've kind of risen in our consciousness of our belief through the systems of life, believing that that is the way that it is, that that's the way that it operates. Now, I'm not speaking for you. I'm sure some of you are way more enlightened than I am. But I still find myself sometimes thinking these little thoughts, these little things coming in. They don't sound like these words anymore, but they sound like energy impulses that come into my being and my life that says, God's going to get you for that. Don't do that because that's wrong and God will get you for it. Or I even find it sometimes in the way that I react to the world and put out to the world, where what I look at is something that needs to be done, and I find myself saying, you know, I could do that. I could step forward and serve in that manner. I could help that person. I could help those people. And maybe it would be the right thing because God would like it if I did it. That's not the God that Dr. Holmes is talking about when he talks about the thing itself. What he is saying is that it reacts in perfection to what my belief is, so that if I take the action and the activity, believing somehow or other that the end result is going to be good because God's going to love it, then the end result will be good because God will love it, despite the fact that I have that little ego thing that sits in the middle that says at the same time, yeah, but if I do it for that reason, then it won't be any good at all, in which case that becomes my reality, and even though I do a good work, because I did it for the wrong reason, it doesn't work for me anyway. Is that a little convoluted? This infinite intelligence lives within us. It is who we are. We cannot see it. We never will see it. When Dr. Holmes wrote the textbook in 1927, he said specifically is that this thing is so large that we cannot grasp it and comprehend it. So he said basically, just forget trying to comprehend it. The Indigo Girls said it by saying, the less I seek the source of my definitive, the closer I am to find. And really, that's what it is the less I try to chase after trying to understand this, probably the closer I am to find. But he was right. Pardon me. He was right in his aspect that someday religion and science will come together, because it's coming together right now. We're finding this in theoretical physics all the time, and people are beginning to demonstrate it and show it. There's certain studies that have been done that demonstrate that our thought, in fact, has a direction and a power which creates form. Quantum physicists decide that that's true. We no longer believe that there is any such thing in quantum physics as a void, that there is something that exists between the neuron and the electron, and that something that exists between the neuron and the electron, they fall short of calling it God, but their intention is to believe and to know that that which is there is a creative field of intelligence, and that it has its own power. Now, this wasn't true in 1927, but the truth that Dr. Holmes wrote about, and by the way, Holmes in the Science of Mind text doesn't know the whole truth, and he knows that. What he does is he knows what he knew at the time. But that which was true in 1927 about the mind itself and about what spirit and God is true in, will be true in 2027, and it'll be equally as true in 3027. And that understanding and that knowledge that we evolve into the appreciation and the understanding of this is what Dr. Holmes talks about. What he talks about is that the day will come when we can actually begin to use this power instead of being frightened of it. And that the natural state of being is one of freedom. And that freedom must be made manifest when we start to use the power and understand the truth of who we are. Because freedom comes from our ability to be able to let go and surrender what we think is actually chaining us and keeping us where we're at. And that's why every great avatar from the beginning of time has said that what you need to do is you need to become the observer and rise above and look at your life from a wholeness as opposed to the partness that fits in with it. So that you can actually see that the system of our lives, it works in perfection just like nature does, and that everything works in perfection. The universe will stand together. It will not fall apart. It will not dissolve. You needn't be worried about 2012, December 21st, when they talk about that, because the universe cannot dissolve. It cannot fall apart. What it can do is it can change and it can transform, but the truth of who you are will go on forever. It will never have a stopping point. It will always move. And why will it always move? Because you are the living individualization of the divinity of that which is infinite. And you cannot be called up short. You are not your body. You are not this planet. What you are the living individualization of the intelligence itself, made form and manifest. And when we stop thinking that somehow or other what we have to do is obey certain rules, because if we obey them, what we'll do is get rewarded. Or if we stop thinking that we shouldn't disobey certain rules, because if we disobey them, we will be punished. What we'll start doing is we'll start working out of our own authentic selves. What we'll start doing is we'll start doing actions based on the fact that that is the truth of who we are, as opposed to based on fear. You see, you can tell spirit in action no matter where you are. It doesn't matter who you're listening to or what's going on. I will tell you how you do it. If it's about love, it's about God. If it's about fear, it's man-made. So it doesn't matter whether you're here or whether you're at a service from some other denomination. If anybody starts standing there and saying that this is the way it needs to be, and if it isn't, then this is what the outcome's going to be, you will know that that feeling of fear that enters into you has been created by the small mind, not the large mind. It has not been created by God. It has been created by the individual itself and being shared back out. This would go a long ways when you're watching the Republican debates right now. It really helps to recognize and know and understand that what you're hearing there is you're hearing the ego base of life. You're not hearing the truth of life that follows through and is the truth and the reality of who we are. To be able to pick out that idea of love is the key and the secret to all of life. Because how it operates, how the system operates, is it operates through a law. And the law is really basic. The law says that for every cause, there is an effect. And that everything is energy, and everything that every time energy moves, then the end result is there's a different effect for it. And we know this. We know how law works and what scientists say. A law is something that works consistently and constantly and always, and that you can rely upon it. That's why this wasn't new. This wasn't Holmes who invented it. It was actually written about by Plato. It was written about by Pythagoras. It's been written about from the beginning of time. That our lives are controlled by a law. And that law in the physical form shows up in many, many different ways. There's the law of gravity. If I were to drop something, it would fall. We could count on that. Matter of fact, we would count on that, which is why a lot of us haven't jumped off buildings thinking somehow or other we can defy it. Well, that's true, because we know and we realize that that law in action will not allow me to be able to fly unless I have created some device to allow me to do it. So, and as a matter of fact, even that device would be using the law, such as an aeroplane, which has uplift on its wings, so it's got forward motion, so it pushes itself up. But it was designed and it was built with the law in mind. It wasn't designed and built with an idea that somehow or other I'm going to invent this special little tube, and that when I have this tube in action and operation, by magic, it will take off and fly. But that's how we use the law of mind on a regular basis. We somehow or other think that it's going to happen by magic. And it doesn't happen by magic. Every time we implant a thought into mind, what happens is it creates a different effect. And every time we take that action and that activity, we can put it out there. And if we are not doing that activity based on the basic premise that Holmes says, that our natural state of being is freedom, then the end result is what we're doing is we're creating an effect unlike freedom that we get to experience in our lives. But what Dr. Holmes says is that if you know how this law works, you know how you put it into action, you know how to make it active in your life, then the end result out of that is that you have the control over your life. You have the control over your circumstances. You have the control over your material. And that's the way that you rise to freedom in your life, is by understanding the law and the principle behind it. And so what we teach 52 weeks a year here is that there is a law in the universe, and that law can be used by us. And that law basically states that there is a life that exists that becomes the form of our experience when we put it in there with thought. That what happens is the world responds to what we're thinking, and as we implant it, it turns it back to us as our experience in what goes on in the world. This is not new news. This has been taught from the beginning of time. If you keep doing the same thing over and over again and expecting it to be different, that the results to be different, then that is not anything less than the misuse of the law. That is not understanding the premise that's behind it. So if you have a problem in your life, if you have a challenge in your life, if you have a conflict in your life, if you have pain in your life, if you have some dissatisfaction in your life, what is required is not to go out and try to change the dissatisfaction, but in reality it is to go within to the cause and find out what it is that your belief system is that's manifesting it, and then utilize and use something to make it different, such as spiritual mind treatment / affirmative prayer. To be able to respond and communicate with your own higher power. When you do a prayer, when you do a spiritual mind treatment, you are not praying to God directly, up in the heavens, outside, someplace outside of yourself. What you are doing is you are communicating with the own truth of you, who you are within you. And you're saying, wake up, Ken. Wake up. Change your mind. You'll get a different circumstance back out of it again. The law works constantly, it works consistently, and it works always. And if you want proof of it, look at your life. Because your life is the direct reflection of your belief system. Now, that's not good or bad. Your life is the direct reflection of your belief system because you are the body and you are the mind and you are the intelligence of that which we call God, and God creates form through us the same way as it creates form, which is through self-contemplation. It creates form by means of you. And that your thought is a prayer, and as you implant it and create a form back out of it again, that's what you get to live with. That's your experience. And if you don't like that experience, you can change it to something else. Now, I said that it has two parts, which is love and law. The second part is law itself, is love itself. And what love is not the love that we're thinking about. Or I shouldn't say that. It's not the love I have a tendency to think about. It's not that human love that fits in there. The love can be defined by me simply as this. It will always operate for the goodness of the whole. It will not operate for the goodness of Kenn Gordon, although if I align myself with the whole, then I don't have to worry about it. Make sense? So it will always operate for that. And why does it operate that way? Because it has to operate that way. How do I know that? Because if it didn't operate that way, then what it would do is be operating in a destructive way. And if it were operating in a destructive way, it couldn't exist because it would self-destruct. And because it's infinite, it would self-destruct infinitely. Therefore, it couldn't exist. Does it make sense? Good. You guys all know or got one up on Troward. Okay. When we talk about, when Dr. Holmes talks about the thing itself, what he's talking about is he is talking about a system of life. And that system of life operates on laws. And that law is that the energy that is moved within it creates form. And the form we have in our life is a reflection of that. And that's what we see. If you begin to move the form of your life in the expression of love, which is for goodness, then the end result is it will create that. It doesn't stop itself and say, well, you know, so-and-so is not doing it in the correct way, so therefore I'm not going to give it any reward back out. That's as silly as the original one with sitting in a clouds with angels as clerks and enforcers. What it is, though, is it operates according to that belief and that consistent thought. So it becomes necessary for us to be able to change the experiences of our lives by understanding that that power is usable by us. And how we use it is we use it by communicating with it. And how we communicate with it is by communicating with our own higher self. And so spiritual mind treatment is in reality, or affirmative prayer, is in reality a self-communication. What it is it is stating, wake up, get a new idea, enforce that new idea, implement that new idea, and put it into your life around you. There's a power in this universe that is greater than I am, and it is mine to use. And that's what Holmes said, and that's what he lived by, and that was his vision or motto, was to live from that place. I'd like to close with the very end of the Science of Mind chapter on the thing itself, which is why I wear my glasses all this time. Oh, I don't have my glasses on. Oh my God, I can't read. You get up in front of a couple hundred people every Sunday and show everybody just how not connected you are. Okay. See how you feel. All right. Okay, so Dr. Holmes ends the thing itself this way. If we try to find something difficult to grasp, then we shall never grasp it, because we shall always think of it as being incomprehensible. The mind which we discover within us is the mind that governs everything. This is the thing itself, and we should recognize its simplicity. Bless you. I love you. Thank you.